So let's just start with this podcast is wildly popular. More than 16 million people have listened to it. How does that make you feel?
It's nerve-wracking for sure.
Why?
It's caused a lot of stress in my life, and my life's been pretty stressful as it is, and hadn't really helped much. Sometimes I regret ever speaking into that microphone because I was probably upset or wasn't thinking clearly. But
do you think that it's an accurate portrayal of your town?
For the most part, there's a lot of accurate stuff in the podcast. Some of it was inaccurate, you know, on everybody's part, really. But there's a lot of stuff goes on around here that really needs to come to light.
What do you think about, if you were to describe Woodstock, Alabama to somebody, would you describe it as, I'm going to bleep this out, but shit town? Is that how you would describe it?
Yep. That's how I pronounce this town.
Why?
I don't know. It has become that, and all the corrupt crookedness of Bibb County in general, which I'm sure, you know, it's happening all over the world, but hell, one shit town ain't no better than the next. But maybe one day I can pack my girls up and do what John B. never did and get the hell out.
How much do you miss him?
I miss him a good bit. I've been pretty upset with him, though, just for doing all this to us. But shit happens in a shit town, I guess.
What was he like when you think about him right now? I mean, before he killed himself, before all of this, before the podcast, when you thought about him, what was he like?
He was brilliant. I mean, he was a brilliant individual, but he was a nutcase. You know, not many people could deal with him. I was probably one of the few that could, and I guess that's why he took a liking to me so much. But I mean, not many people could work for him or deal with him. He was weird and pissed people off.
Why were you drawn to him?
I mean, I could tell he cared about me, so it made me care about him, and he just become family to us all. And I mean, our leftovers, I'd bring to him and his mama every evening and bring her biscuits or muffins in the morning whenever I come over there. I came over there every single day for years, you know. So.
You think about him often?
Yeah, I think about him and Mary Grace and that land over there. You know, it meant the world to me. And it's heartbreaking for sure.
How are you doing now?
Yeah. Not real good. Not what people think, for sure. Just depressed and mentally ill. Just trying to keep going on for these babies.
What do you hope for your future? What are you trying to, you know, this story came out, it put this spotlight on you in your town. People look at you at baseball games. What do you hope for yourself now?
I don't know, maybe we can clean this town up, clean this county up, get some of this trash out of these courthouses and stuff and get it back on track. I mean, that would be nice, but it's just wishful thinking.
Do you want to stay here?
I mean, if I was to hit the big time or something, and if my granny wanted to leave from here, I'd pack her and every one of us up and get the heck out of here. But if she wanted to stay, then I'd stay here and make her comfortable for the rest of her days. And then we'd probably pack up and go somewhere. But she's, you know, she's 90-something years old, and she's still working and tending to people over there. She still can't even retire or nothing. I'd love to be able to let her retire and be comfortable for once.
Was it surprising to you how popular this podcast has become?
Yeah, it was a surprise. I didn't think anybody would ever care about any of this stuff. I mean, whenever Brian was interviewing me, I just didn't think much of it because it was, I'm like, Brian, why would anybody care about anything to do with my pitiful old life? I just thought he was bored. And John B. thought he was broke and his company was broke. He often tried to offer them money for his time and travels, but that wasn't the case.
When did you listen to it? Like, when did you find out that it was out? When did you listen to it?
Oh, Brian was letting me know before it was coming out because he wanted me to listen to it first just so nothing would be a surprise to me, which I don't see what that would have helped any, but yeah, I squalled my eyes out the first few hours of it, and then couldn't crawl out of my room for a while, and still can't hardly, but.
Did you listen to it pretty quickly? Like, how long did it take you to get through all 7 episodes?
Well, it's been rough. I didn't listen to all of it at once. I mean, when it got to all that fruity stuff, I had to cut it off. You know, nothing against homosexuals or whatever, but I just, it was a surprise to me, really, and I didn't think that it would have went that deep, you know, but, I mean, people like it, I guess, you know, whatever, but I guess they're going to criticize me regardless, but I don't care.
My last question, because I told you this would be short, my last question is, for what do you want people to know about you or about Woodstock? You know, that podcast, they got to tell their own story as it is. What do you want people to know about all of this?
Shoot, I don't know. I mean, I could talk to you all day, you know, about that really, but I don't know. I don't think I could change anybody's mind unless I give them my side of the story, you know, but people's gonna believe what they're gonna believe, you know. But it's an interesting story overall, I guess, outside looking in, but me being a part of it, it's a whole different story, you know.
It's your life.
It's sad, yeah. It is sad, especially the way everything's panned out. I don't know. I don't know if I answered your question right or not, but maybe something will happen in the end. But I'm no criminal. I'm not the thief. You know. But we'll see what happens.